So today, as I mentioned, we're going to be looking at the story of the California Volunteers. And those are the men who answered their country's call and signed up to fight rebels at the beginning of the Civil War. The young man in the slide is Henry Philibrown, and he was the first man to enlist in an elite cavalry unit that became known as the California 100. Henry listed his pre-war occupation as vaquero, and he spent 2 years, two very, very dangerous years, applying his skill to the pursuit of John Singleton Mosby, who is arguably the most dangerous guerrilla leader this country ever produced. This is another slide of California Volunteers. The man circled at the right is named George Pettis. His war took a very different turn. In late 1864, George found himself 250 miles out in the wastes of the Llano Estacado in North Texas, where he and his friends found themselves outnumbered 10 to 1 by raging Comanches. This was a considerable disappointment to George, who expected to be fighting Confederates. In fact, California's volunteers signed up to save the Union from secessionist traitors, but they ended up instead scattered across the western United States, trying to enforce a fragile peace with native peoples or waging relentless war on them if the peace failed. So our program today will show how this odd state of affairs came about and what it meant to the Californians who volunteered to serve their country. First, a few slides that describe the state of affairs in pre-war California. This is one of my favorites. It depicts a crowded public place in California in 1845. In fact, what you're looking at now is a rush hour traffic jam. And this is what a crowded public place looked like in California in 1851. This is San Francisco with Yerba Buena Island in the midground. Now, 250,000 people had poured into California from around the world by the time this photo was taken. So by 1860, we have a population of 380,000. Now, these immigrants who poured into California from the states brought their politics with them. So Southerners remained Southerners and Northerners Northerners. And so it wasn't surprising that the question of slavery became a hot button issue at the Constitutional Convention at Colton Hall in Monterey. What was surprising is that the convention voted unanimously against allowing black slavery in the new state. This was, of course, not a gesture of support for black rights. Far from it, California came very close to banning blacks altogether. But the reality was that one man, one claim was the watchword of Gold Rush California. And no miner from North or South wanted to compete with slave-powered mining companies. Political tensions in California increased steadily over the 1850s. You folks probably know about the duel between David Terry and David Broderick, in which our Chief Justice shot and killed our junior senator. It was a dispute between factional leaders of the Democratic Party. So in a state where dueling was a leading form of outdoor recreation, a few public slurs by one man for another led to this very public murder just before the outbreak of the war. So that's how precarious California politics really were at that point in the critical year of 1860. That's the year that the Democratic Party split into Northern and Southern factions, with each fielding its own presidential candidate, as shown in this cartoon. And when the dust settled, voters were left with four candidates for president. This is the result of the 1860 presidential election. This is as clear an expression of regional politics as the country has ever seen. Now, looking at this map, you could easily infer that California was a Union state, just like any of the others that went for Lincoln. But the truth is much more interesting. Here's the popular vote nationwide. Lincoln won the election with only 40% of the total. If he'd been facing a United Democratic Party, he would have been buried. So he really was a sectional candidate. His name didn't even appear on ballots in the South. And here's how California voted. Lincoln's portion shrinks. He runs 8 points below where he did nationally. Breckinridge, the Southern Democrat, runs a whopping 10 points better. So California was decidedly more Southern than the nation as a whole. In the end, Lincoln won California by about 700 votes, which amounts to half a percentage point of the total. This is the election by county, and if you look at the national map from east to west, you'll see a near-perfect division between the North and the South. You've got Lincoln and Douglas on one side, and Bell and Breckinridge on the other, until you get to Missouri, where order breaks down. Now, the implications of this were dire. Missouri suffered the most vicious partisan fighting of the war, and it was because people were divided in their allegiance. And California was the same, only more so. This map shows how scattered the political landscape of California really was. Lincoln won the Bay Area, except for the peninsula, and Nevada and San Bernardino counties. Douglas captured the top quarter of the state and Ventura and Santa Barbara counties. Breckinridge, the Southern candidate who later became a general for the Confederacy, won vast rural counties and swept the Southern mines. So based on what happened in Missouri, you could predict that our state would have been fertile ground for a Confederate partisan campaign based in the Southern mines. The election of Abraham Lincoln led directly to the secession of South Carolina on December 20th, 1860. The rest of the Deep South swiftly followed South Carolina out of the Union. After the shelling of Fort Sumter on April 12th, 1861, Lincoln called for troops to suppress the rebellion, and most of the Upper South ignored his request. They marched off and joined the Confederacy instead, ensuring that full-scale war was now a certainty. Now, at this point, no one knew if California would stay in the Union. Abraham Lincoln and Jefferson Davis both had high hopes for the state. Lincoln had just won the state's electoral votes, but California's delegation was solidly pro-Southern. They assured Jefferson Davis that the Golden State would not interfere with his attempts to build a new nation. John Downey, a 32-year-old Irish immigrant, was governor of California at the start of the war. He was a Democrat, allied to the chivalry, and he opposed using force to bring the Southern states back into the Union. His conduct in office was so alarming to Unionists that they petitioned the Secretary of War to leave regular U.S. troops in California, and their request was granted. At the peak of the crisis, however, in mid-1861, Governor Downey acceded to the War Department's request to raise volunteer troops to maintain order in California and to take over the duties of the regular army in the West. So this demonstrates how tangled and confusing the situation really was as the Union began to break apart. Downey was an Irishman who had been lifted into the governorship by Southern Democrats. Nonetheless, he felt duty-bound to raise troops for the U.S. War Department. Another man caught up in the tumult of the times was Albert Sidney Johnston, a charismatic Southerner recently installed as commander of the U.S. Army Department of the Pacific. Johnston was a highly distinguished officer whose appointment to the Western Command was widely seen by Unionists as part of a plot to place Southern officers in key positions in the event of war. This is a gun, a big gun, on Alcatraz Island, And that was part of the fortifications that guarded the entrance to San Francisco Bay. These were vital defenses. Sidney Johnson also had arms for 75,000 men under his command. Now, Southern sympathizers in California expected Johnson to hand over the Pacific arsenal, as it happened throughout the South. But Johnson refused to betray his officer's oath. He resigned his command instead and headed for Los Angeles. Now, Johnson was 58 years old and ready to retire after a lifetime of service. But as pressure mounted on him, he reconsidered. And finally, he enlisted as a private in the Los Angeles Mounted Rifles, which was a secessionist militia unit. I'm not sure everybody knows we had secessionist militia units, but we certainly did. The Rifles were real enthusiasts. Their goal was to hurry back and fight for the South, and this is what they proceeded to do. The march from Los Angeles to Mesilla took them 800 miles over some of the harshest terrain on Earth. They crossed the desert in June and July. This was ill-advised. This is one of the cheerier sections near the Mexican border. And in addition to dodging federal patrols, Johnston and the Rifles also had to pass through the domain of the Chiricahua Apache, who were not encouraging tourism at this time. The route lay between one of the hottest regions of the world, where the thermometer often marked 120 degrees, and the trip turned into a brutal ordeal where life and death hung on reaching the next waterhole. Johnston pressed on all the way to Richmond, where Jefferson Davis appointed him to command the Army of Tennessee, the main force defending the Confederacy west of the Appalachians. In April of 1862, Johnston surprised General U.S. Grant at Shiloh and came within a hair of tossing him and his army into the Tennessee River. At the height of the battle, Johnston was wounded in the leg, and his life could have been saved by a simple tourniquet, but he had just sent his personal physician to care for a group of Yankee soldiers. Johnston was eulogized throughout the South and came to stand for the chivalric ideal, which Southerners associate with their cause. But as California, who owes the most to Johnston, his refusal to betray his officer's oath spared the state from war in 1861. Johnston's successor to the Pacific Command was General Edwin Sumner. Sumner's first job was to strengthen California's defense against internal threats, particularly in the south part of the state, which was overwhelmingly secessionist. Sumner positioned his regular troops accordingly while launching an ambitious program to recruit and train volunteer regiments. Sumner was ordered back east in October of 61, and he was replaced by General George Wright, who held the Pacific Command until 1864. So California's volunteer regiments were drawn mainly from Northern California, which was home to most of the emigrants from the free states. Many of these volunteers were sent directly to Southern California where they were needed. Camps Latham, Drum, and Wright were established in Southern California to turn the new recruits into effective soldiers while keeping them close to secessionist hotspots. When word of a planned Confederate invasion of New Mexico began to circulate in the fall of 1861, Union volunteers were marched to Fort Yuma on the Colorado River to quell any Confederate mischief that might arise. Now, the rebel threat was real. Federal forts in West Texas had fallen swiftly at the beginning of the crisis, and there was strong secessionist feeling among settlers along the Mexican border. In March of 1861, these settlers voted to cast their lot with the South, and they declared themselves the Confederate territory of Arizona, with their capital at Mesilla, And you can see that Confederate Arizona ran differently from our Arizona. It was, it went along the lines of latitude. Now, the Confederacy's hopes in the Southwest were pinned on this man, General Henry Hopkins Sibley. And in December of 1861, Sibley marched out of Texas with 3,000 men, 18 cannon, and a very generous supply of whiskey, which he proceeded to drink. And I've always wanted to open a brewery so I could put his picture on a whiskey bottle. I don't know that you could find a better one. Not that great a general, though. His plan was to drive Union forces out of New Mexico and capture Fort Union, which was the hub of the federal supply lines in the Southwest. In his spare time, Sibley was to crush the Apaches, push into California, maybe break off a few provinces of Western Mexico, and add them to the Confederacy. So as you can see, campaign planning at the start of the war tended to be optimistic. The Confederate campaign started off really well. On February 21st of 1862, Sibley's Texans defeated Union forces in a really hard-fought action at Valverde Ford on the Rio Grande. A week later, a detachment from Sibley's army occupied Tucson and joined forces there with the local secessionist militia. Now, Union forces on the Pacific coast were aware, as I mentioned, of the Confederate plans for New Mexico, and in response, 1,500 Californians assembled at Fort Yuma under the command of James Carleton. This force was dubbed the California Column, and its numbers eventually rose to 2,350 men. The column was a mixed force of volunteer infantry and cavalry, strengthened by a battery of regular artillery. Its mission was to drive east and help drive the invading Confederates back to Texas. And this was no easy job. Bringing troops to action in the Southwest during the Civil War was a lot like fighting on the moon would be today. Yes, you needed to think about engaging the enemy, but the greater challenge was getting your people to the battlefield. Horse and mule-drawn wagon trains require massive amounts of fodder, and there are few places on earth that offer less forage than the American Southwest. Water was also a critical problem for Carleton. Men and animals had to be divided up into small parties, and their marches meticulously timed to allow meager springs and wells to replenish before the next thirsty party arrived. General Carleton sent out spies and scouts to create supply depots along the column's route and to barter for hay with local Indians. Meanwhile, Confederate patrols fanned out from Tucson to find Union supply depots and destroy them. These forces came into contact in a skirmish at Picacho Pass, which has been called the westernmost action of the Civil War. Now, while Yankees and Confederates skirmished around Tucson, Sibley's main force continued north in search of supplies. His men took Albuquerque and Santa Fe. His troops then advanced on well-stocked Fort Union, but were stopped at Glorieta Pass by a mixed force of regulars and volunteers from Colorado. The Confederates held the field at the end of the fight, but a Union end run during the battle located Sibley's supply train and destroyed it. So Sibley's position quickly became desperate, and he retreated to Texas with Union forces in close pursuit. So the Confederates were already in full retreat when the first troops of the California Column reached the Rio Grande on July 4th. On the way, the volunteers got a taste of what the rest of their war was going to look like. On July 11th, two companies of Californians were ambushed near a waterhole at Apache Pass. They were hit by 500 very angry Chiricahua warriors under Cochise and Mangas Coloradas. It was a very hard-fought action, and only the presence of two mountain howitzers saved the soldiers from disaster. Now, after the California Column crossed the Southwest, General Carleton was given command of the Department of New Mexico, which in those days included the region that we now call Arizona. So this was the theater in which the column served out the rest of its war, fighting alongside New Mexican volunteers who were, like the Californians, a mix of old Mexican stock and Anglos from the States. New Mexico in that era was a poor land that suffered from chronic warfare amongst rival populations. Native tribesmen were well aware of the war raging back east amongst the whites. As regular U.S. troops were withdrawn to meet the crisis, many tribes seized the opportunity to push back against white settlers who were encroaching on native lands. In 1862, for instance, estimated property loss from Indian raids in New Mexico amounted to $250,000, $1,862 dollars. That's like 7 million of them today. And this is the amazing part. Navajo raiders alone counted for 30,000 stolen sheep. So you had also a death toll of white settlers that approached 300. James Carleton, the new department commander, was an extremely competent soldier. He's tireless and incorruptible. He sprang from Calvinist stock and seemed to regard Indian violence as a personal affront. Carleton was a full-blooded New England Puritan on both sides, and that may explain the lethal combination of idealism and inflexibility that marked his dealings with Indian tribes. General Carleton decided that the key problem of his new command was the Navajo people, or the Diné, as they refer to themselves. His top priority would be to put an end to their raiding. To lead this campaign against the Navajo, Carleton selected his most able commander, Kit Carson, a man with whom he had worked for years and trusted entirely. Carson is just a fascinating character. His pivotal role in California history has almost faded from memory, but it was Carson who guided the young John Fremont to California, and it was Carson who almost single-handedly saved Stephen Kearny's force from being wiped out by Californios during the Mexican-American War. Carson married into the Mexican community at Santa Fe, adopted Roman Catholicism, and spoke Spanish at home. His relationship with his wife, Josefa, was one of the great love stories of the American West. And if there are any romance novelists in the audience, remember that you heard it here first. Kit Carson was old by frontier standards and ill at the time that General Carleton recruited him to lead the campaign against the Diné. By this point in his life, Carson just wanted to stay home with his family, but General Carleton was relentless. He knew just how to play on Carson's sense of duty. Carleton convinced the old scout that it was his mission to lift New Mexico out of violence and bloodshed. Carleton then laid out for his friend a compelling vision of how the Indian problem could be solved. The first step was to launch a powerful expedition against the Diné in their homeland and subdue them. The entire tribe was then to be rounded up and marched off to a new home at Bosque Redondo, that is some 300 miles away. The Bosque Redondo, or Round Forest, was a seeming oasis on the Pecos River that Carleton had scouted when he was a dragoon officer before the war. His plan was to remove the Navajo from their homeland and turn them into full-time agriculturalists, far from the white settlements that presented such tempting targets to the young warriors. Schools would be provided for Indian children, and Christian instruction would be available free to all. But first, the Diné had to be rounded up. Now, the heart of Diné Da, the Navajo homeland, was the Canyon de Chelly, and it is a natural fortress of enormous strength. earlier Mexican and American expeditions had come to grief trying to enter it. Carson set off in July of 1863 with almost 1,000 men, including California and New Mexico volunteers, and some regular U.S. Army officers, and an important band of Ute scouts. Carson had a special affinity for the Ute people, and he served as their spokesman in negotiations with the U.S. government. Carson, in fact, usually rode with his Ute scouts when he was out in campaign. So Carson started by reestablishing two ruined forts. He then sent out patrol after patrol across the Diné land. His troops rarely found Indians, but they did find the ripening corn fields that were meant to feed the Diné throughout the winter, as well as many sheep and horses. All were destroyed. Finally, in January of 64, General Carleton decided it was time to take the war into the very heart of the Navajo Nation, into Canyon de Chelly itself. When Carson's troops found there was that starvation and disease had already done their work for them. The handful of Diné they captured were already half dead. After 6 months of raiding, Carson had the Navajo at his mercy. He sent out emissaries to tell them to come in. The first four who did were brutally mistreated by an imbecile major who was in command in Carson's absence. Two Navajo were killed, one beaten, and one escaped to tell his people that the soldiers were there to exterminate them. Carson was enraged by the major's stupidity and did what he could to bring the rest of the Navajo in safely. Relocation was the ultimate goal, however, and the process was brutal. The Navajo were forced to walk 300 miles under armed guard to Bosque Redondo. The Diné who came in numbered 8,000 to 9,000, and they marched in 50 parties. Unfortunately, many of the New Mexico volunteers who oversaw the march viewed the Diné as ancestral enemies, and they did what they could to increase their suffering. At least 200 Navajo died along the way. Their ordeal became known as the Long Walk. It's a tragic episode that remains seared in tribal memory to this day. When the Diné got to Bosque Redondo, they pitched in and built an extensive irrigation system. 3,000 acres of corn were planted and the plants flourished. It wasn't until a few weeks before harvest that they discovered that the entire crop had been destroyed from the inside by cutworms. Equally disastrous was the fact that the Bosque was situated on the edge of Comancheria, the inland empire of the Comanche people and their Kiowa and Kiowa Apache allies, who immediately began attacking the disarmed Navajo in their new home. Comanche and Kiowa raids on the Bosque Redondo threatened to undo General Carleton's cherished project. So Carleton turned again to Kit Carson, dragging the old scout out of retirement to lead a retaliatory raid. Carson's objective was the winter camps of the Comanche along the Canadian River. Now, here are some of the officers of the California Column who rode with Carson against the Comanche. Major William McCleave came to California from Northern Ireland in 1850 and enlisted in the Dragoons. He rose to sergeant and was the Army's chief camel herder when the war broke out, thereby rescuing McCleave from the camels. At the start of the war, he was breveted captain of volunteers, and he helped organize the 1st California Cavalry. I won't go into details on him, but I just say he was captured by Confederates early in that campaign, and they couldn't release him fast enough. They traded him right away for a pair of Confederate lieutenants because they recognized a belligerent Scotch-Irishman when they saw one. And then he turned down his pay for the time that he was captured on the grounds that he hadn't done anything useful during that time. Now, at right is Captain George Pettis, our Sacramento area printer, who may have believed that the pen was mightier than the sword, but he learned through experience that the cannon was mightier than either. Pettis was a gifted writer, and it is through his eyes that we get the best view of the campaign and its climactic battle at Adobe Walls. So in November 1864, Carson set out with 400 men, including 75 Ute scouts, two companies of cavalry, and one of infantry. Oh, and a pair of mountain howitzers. They headed out into the Texas Panhandle and marched 250 miles. And at dusk on November 24th, two Ute scouts came in as the soldiers were setting up camp. Carson chatted with the scouts and then summed up their report for his officers. "We will have," Carson said, "no difficulty finding all the Indians that we desire." Now, there are, of course, no contemporary visual records of the battle, so I'll show images of some of the individuals and groups who participated as I describe the events of that day. After learning about the Indians ahead, Carson left his supply wagons with a guard of 75 infantrymen and advanced under moonlight with his cavalry. The soldiers got to within a few miles of the first Indian village, a Kiowa camp belonging to Dohasan, and they waited there in silence for sunrise. When the sky finally lightened, the soldiers resumed their march. Kiowa pickets spotted them, and the race was on. Carson sent McLeve's cavalry ahead to attack the village. Carson followed with an escort bringing the two mountain howitzers, which could only move at a walking pace through the soft river bottom. Now, these weapons were the artillery of choice in the open spaces of the Southwest. They could lob shells that exploded at a distance, or they could be packed with canister and be used as giant shotguns if your enemy got too close. As McLeve's cavalry approached the village, they stumbled into a bit of luck. Most of the Kiowa men were away in a war party. The guards who remained, however, engaged the soldiers long enough to let the women and children escape into the sandy hills north of camp. Then the Kiowa warriors themselves withdrew towards a large Comanche village that was just visible some miles downstream. This is an online map of the battle. In the lower left circled there is where Carson left his wagons. And this is where McLeve attacked the Kiowa village. McLeve then followed the retreating Kiowa, and there was a running fight all the way. Then Indian resistance stiffened as swarms of Comanches showed up to join the fight. McLeve and his men wisely took shelter in the ruins of an old trading fort called Adobe Walls. And that's where Carson and his cavalrymen joined McLeve at around 10 a.m. Meanwhile, Indian reinforcements poured in from the big Comanche village in plain sight a mile away. Some of Carson's officers actually urged him to advance and attack the second village, but Kit Carson was a lot brighter than George Custer. He decided he was going to just sit tight, which proved to be a really good decision. Dohasan's village held about 200 lodges. Now, the Comanche village downstream consisted of around 500. So reckoning two warriors per teepee, as the frontiersmen did, and allowing for the Kiowa men who were away in a war party, Carson could count on something like 1,200 angry, well-armed Indians coming his way at any moment. So the odds at this point stood about 4-1 against Carson, and they were only going to get worse as word of the battle spread and outlying Comanche warriors joined the fight. Carson hid his horses and wounded men behind the walls of the old fort and deployed his dismounted cavalrymen as skirmishers in the tall grass. Meanwhile, Carson's Ute scouts fought on horseback with the Kiowa warriors in sort of individual duels. But now the main mass of the Comanche fighters began to move forward, ready to sweep Carson and his men off the earth and into the history books. And it was just at this moment that Carson's two howitzers arrived at the gallop. The guns were slung in place atop a knoll near the fort, and Carson instructed Captain Pettis to throw a few shell into that crowd over there. And the guns roared out. Pettis later summed up the Indians' reaction in his account of the campaign. "They rose high in their stirrups and gazed for a single moment with astonishment. Then gave one concerted, prolonged yell. They started from a dead run, rather, for their village. And in fact, when the fourth shot was fired, there was not a single enemy within the extreme range of the howitzers." So the howitzers came as an unwelcome surprise to the Indians, who had never encountered them before. In later accounts of the battle, they referred to these weapons as the guns that shoot twice. The first shot was, of course, the loud report of the gun being fired. The second was the sound of a fused shell exploding in their ranks. So the Indians fled out of range as soon as the weapon's terrible effect became clear. Carson thought the fighting was over, but for once, the legendary scout was wrong. Within half an hour, the Indians were back, this time dispersed over the countryside so as not to offer themselves as targets to the howitzers. The gentleman in this slide is Stumbling Bear, who wore his young daughter's shawl into battle as a good luck charm. It worked. After the engagement, Stumbling Bear counted 12 bullet holes in the shawl. He himself was unscathed. During the engagement, Carson relied on his bugler to relay commands to his men who were out of voice range. In this fight, however, the system went awry. Whenever Carson's bugler would play advance, a second bugler would sound retreat, and vice versa. Now, at first, this confused the soldiers, but after a while, they figured out that the phantom bugler had to be an Indian. From that point on, the dueling bugle calls provided a much-needed bit of comic relief for Carson's very weary men. Here's the bugler. This is Satanta, a Kiowa warrior, as well as part-time bugler. In his youth, he had apparently acquired an army bugle and taught himself to play it. This proved a very good investment of his time. The battle itself, however, went on for hours, and as the Indians mounted attack after attack, Carson's defense was very hard-pressed. If it had wavered for a minute, not a man of this command would have seen Santa Fe again. For the Comanche and Kiowa, the stakes were equally high. Their villages contained the food and shelter that would see their people through the winter. As the afternoon wore on, Carson's men grew exhausted and started running low on ammunition. They were also worried about their supplies. They had seen Indians slipping past them, heading west, and if the Comanche succeeded in capturing Carson's wagon train, he and his men would find themselves 250 miles from the nearest fort without food or ammunition. So Carson ordered a retreat, and a running battle ensued that really involved the hardest fighting of the day. When Carson reached the Kiowa village that they had attacked earlier, he found that the Indians had reoccupied it and were trying to defend it. Carson's men drove them out again and destroyed the village entirely. The soldiers later described the place as stuffed with buffalo robes of the highest quality, as well as loot from numerous raids on wagon trains, including a carriage and an army ambulance. The Indians' resistance was impassioned, and in the end, they did indeed drive off the soldiers. Summing up the Indians' conduct, Carson later said, "They acted with more daring and bravery than I have ever before witnessed." But the reality was that Carson had counted coup on the Indians. He had invaded the heart of Comancheria, destroyed an important village, and inflicted heavy casualties on his enemies while suffering few of his own. So the implications of this campaign were clear enough. The destruction of the vast Comanche Empire was now only a matter of time, and not much time at that. Now, I have focused on the wartime experience of the California Column because it's a good story and relatively well documented. It is also emblematic of the experience of the California volunteers who signed up to fight rebels and ended up fighting Indians instead. The work was hard, cruel, and dangerous, and it was filled with moral ambiguities that many of the soldiers felt keenly. I don't have time to describe some of the other actions, but some of them were really ghastly and must have haunted the men who were on them. This presentation would not be complete, however, without mentioning the exploits of the California volunteers, who did indeed make it back east to fight the rebels, serving in regiments raised by other states. This is an enlistment roll call for the famed California Battalion, who served in the Virginia Theater with the 2nd Massachusetts Volunteer Cavalry. The California Battalion was an elite unit selected for their outstanding horsemanship, as well as for their lack of wives and children. Their unenviable assignment was to hunt down John Singleton Mosby, who is arguably the most dangerous partisan leader this country has ever produced. Mosby got to know the Californians well, and he considered them the toughest opponents he faced during the war. The Californians who survived their encounters with Mosby later served as shock troops under their commander, Colonel Charles Lowell. They rode to fame at the Battle of Cedar Creek, which was a desperate seesaw fight that ultimately destroyed the Confederacy's hopes in the Shenandoah Valley. That victory catapulted General Phil Sheridan to fame and helped reelect Abraham Lincoln in the fall of 1864, though it came at the cost of Colonel Lowell's life. Charles Lowell was the brother-in-law of Robert Gould Shaw, who died, as most of you know, probably leading the 54th Massachusetts in their assault on Fort Wagner, which was depicted in the film Glory. Both are honored by plaques now in the wall of Memorial Hall at Harvard. So the Californians who survived Cedar Creek rode on with Phil Sheridan, and they were there when that hard-fighting general blocked Lee's escape route from Richmond. This action led to the surrender of the Army of Northern Virginia at Appomattox Courthouse in April of 1865. So the California Battalion saw some of the hardest fighting in the Eastern Theater, and they had the casualty lists to prove it. Of the 502 men who joined the battalion, only 182 were still in service at the end of the war. And the reward for their valor was the privilege of paying their own way home after the fighting. The hand-picked cavalrymen of the California Battalion fought back east, but most of California's almost 16,000 volunteers performed their service in the west, where their campaigns were grueling and dangerous. By war's end, California had actually supplied more volunteers per capita than any other state in the Union. This probably reflects the fact that the state's population was largely composed of adventurous young men. And wherever they fought, the Californians proved exceptional soldiers. Now, in this presentation, I've offered a thumbnail sketch of the adventures of the California volunteers. Those of you who are interested in the details can find them in my book, California and the Civil War. The book also describes Confederate partisan activity in California, which included several spirited attempts to intercept our gold shipments on their way back east. I also provide an entertaining look into the state's pro-Southern newspapers, which features some of the most dreadful secessionist poetry ever penned. Accompanying the video upload is a link to a work of fiction that I co-authored. The story is based on some of that Confederate partisan activity I mentioned. Up near where I live in the foothills, a gang of Confederates ambushed a stagecoach carrying $58,000. Which the partisans were going to use to finance their way back east to fight for Jeff Davis. We cleaned up the gang leader a bit, transforming him from a sociopathic killer to a handsome, urbane Virginian lawyer, which is why they call the genre historical fiction. I should add that the real protagonist of the story is Nevada City, the queen of the northern mines, which was at the same time both an international cultural center and a barely tamed frontier town. I'll also include a link to the website of California Educational Multimedia, where I host a webpage that includes more stories about this very little-known period of California's history. And so I think that's the end of the presentation. Now I get to see if any of this worked by switching out of Keynote. And wow, there's still people here. Good. I'm going to unmute. There's no unmute all. I'll just go down and ask people to unmute if you're interested in chatting or if you have any questions.
Well, I'd like to thank you for a very engaging presentation. I have a sense of just how much more there is and likely in your book. But what we got was really very, very interesting. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. It's a heck of a story. And we got into it. Terry Meekins and I wrote, she's here actually, we wrote the fiction book, and we kept hearing people say, well, California had nothing going on during the Civil War. They were sort of disappointed at the time of the sesquicentennial. And Terry came across a book that contained the story of a stagecoach robbery, which I referred to, $58,000 picked up by Confederate partisans. And I read it. She brought it to my attention. I read it and I thought, okay, well, criminals are never at a loss to justify their actions. And my immediate thought was that $58,000 went to the nearest bar and whorehouse and not a penny of it got any farther. But in fact, those partisans, and they really were partisans, left a receipt with the driver of the stagecoach, and he could fill in the amount that he lost. And so the money they stole would be redeemed in the war settlement, right? Fat chance. Anyway, they were real. The guy who led that raid had fought with some of the most vicious partisans in Missouri, people who really were psychopaths. And he had come out to California to scoop up some more rebels and bring them back east to join the fun. As it turned out, it wasn't on that large a scale. So regular law enforcement was able to deal with them, but it was a bloody mess. There were several shootouts, and it's a horrible episode, really. So it was real. You know, California was in play. Not many people down in Southern California had much nice to say about the Union. And if Albert Sidney Johnston had decided to start a scrap, he would have been able to make this place very lively. It would have looked like Missouri. And he was very conscious of how truly horrible that would be. And there's some very eloquent quotes from him saying, if you want to fight in this war, if you feel compelled to fight for one side or the other, you go back east. Because if we have a fight out here, it's going to be neighbor against neighbor. And there's just no telling where that abyss, you know, bottoms out. So he's quite a guy, Albert Sidney. Yeah. Any questions in the text? Hi, Joanne.
I gather from one of our former members who wrote a book about California and the Civil War. She wanted to write a book just about the minister, the Unitarian minister in San Francisco.
Yes.
The conclusion she came to was that California really bankrolled, especially the gold rush,
yes,
and the results of the gold rush, really bankrolled the northern efforts.
Yes.
Is that something that you've also concluded?
Yes, very much so. And I cover that in the book. California provided gold. And one of the great problems of both governments was trying to get enough credit to buy war supplies from Europe. And the Confederacy's gold came from patriotic Southern women melting down their jewelry. California provided a much more reliable and plentiful source to the Union. Now, I'm not quite sure of how that gold mined in California enters the control of the federal government. There must have been some system for taking that gold and giving somebody a piece of paper out here. I'd love to find out somebody who can explain that. But the net effect was that the federal government had gold supplies. And in fact, there's a great quote from General Grant saying that he doesn't know what they would have done without the gold from California. And the other place where California gold came in just critically was in the Sanitary Commission. And that was the Soldiers' Aid Society. That the U.S. government had no facilities for aiding veterans or their families. You were just out of luck if the guy on your farm was shot and killed. So the Sanitary Commission was a private organization, and a quarter of all of its funds came from Californians. Mm-hmm. And I can't help but think what that was the patriotic feelings of Californians who just were too far away to fight, or, you know, didn't care to fight, but they did feel like they wanted to help. And so Thomas Starr King is the name of that minister
that Joanne
just mentioned. He's a terrific story, and he led that effort to get gold out of California merchants, and you can see how successful he was. California had a population the size of Vermont, right? It was a tiny state. It was barely a state, and yet it provided a quarter of all those funds, and much of it was a direct result of Starr King's brilliance as a public speaker. I mean, not only did he have a great voice, he was a little tiny guy, he was about 5'2" or something like that. And he always disappointed people who came to see him. You know, they looked and say, well, where's the great Starr King? You know, and he could barely see over the lectern. But he had this beautiful, big voice that people remarked upon. And more important still, he had a terrific sense of humor. You know, if he hadn't been born in the 19th century, if he'd been born in our century, he would have been a writer for some of the late night comics. He's really fun. And you know, he also happens to be a universal Unitarian. I forget which U is which, but he was a
UU.
Yeah. Okay.
And yeah, so that big church in San Francisco. Yeah.
And
so the detriment of his own life, because he died young.
He did. He worked himself to death in the cause of the Union and in the cause of his church.
A lot of what I know about that period comes from Glenna Matthews' book.
Oh, yeah.
Published by.
Yeah, I've read it.
Cambridge. Yeah. Anyway, that's the
yes. She really focused. She focuses on Star King. If you want, volumes of detail about Star King, she's a good source. I deal with Star King, but I think my effort was more on the political and on the military side, because nobody has covered the military side except episodically, a little piece here and there. But there are a number of interesting stories that I thought deserved airing. And I also really enjoyed analyzing what happened politically, how California, which was a largely Southern state as far as political connection was concerned during the 1850s, turned out into the powerhouse for the Union that it became.
Speaking of politics, there's a question in the chat from Walt Stevenson. How does John Fremont fit into this picture?
Oh, Fremont was really detached from California by the time the war broke out. He had a command in what was called the Western Theater, but what that really meant was west of the Appalachians and between the Appalachians and the Mississippi. So he wasn't part of our orbit. He had already been a presidential candidate in 1856, and he really proved that the Republican Party at that time was viable politically. He got a lot of votes, but he didn't win. And when the war broke out, Lincoln gave him a command, but Fremont was a serious abolitionist, and he went way ahead of Lincoln in issuing statements saying, I'm here to free all the slaves. And he gave those statements out in Missouri, which was a slave state and very much in play. They had a Confederate shadow government, and they had a lot of partisans. And Lincoln just freaked out. He was horrified because he was scared to death of losing Kentucky and Missouri. There's a lot of good stories about Fremont, but none of them really engaged California's experience of the war. My opinion is Fremont sending his wife to go berate Abraham Lincoln for interfering with his command. And Jesse Fremont was, if anybody could berate Abraham Lincoln, she's a good candidate. Interesting woman.
Question.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, it has to do with the volunteers and the chain of command. With these guys volunteering, did they leave at any time? And who was how were the officers of the volunteers treated amongst the regular official military?
Well, the regular military actually was in command. The California volunteers were led out of the U.S. Department of the Pacific, which was actually based in San Francisco. So when they wrote their reports, that's where they would write to. And they were also fortunate at the beginning to have the regular army out here in the West. There were about 17,000 regular troops who were patrolling 2 million square miles of Western real estate when the war broke out. And so California had a disproportionately high number of trained officers and non-coms to turn into officers. And so the Californians who were raised out here were raised as volunteer units, but they frequently had professionals at their head. And that turned out to be lucky for them, because they were sent off to fight in places where your life was very much at risk from the landscape alone, much less angry Indians who wanted to take you home and make you the star of a rather grisly victory celebration. So they were well led. They were very well led. And it was by regular army. Now, sometimes officers later in the war, you'd find regular army officers out here, and it was because nobody back east wanted them. So there's some incidents that I've read about where that major, for instance, that I mentioned in the Diné campaign, the guy who decided that the best way to contact the Diné and make them feel welcome is to beat the hell out of a group who just came in to surrender. That kind of officer was left out west for a reason. But the California volunteers were trained in 1861 by really the cream of the crop. We had everybody. The guys who went east with the Los Angeles Mounted Rifles actually turned out to be a core of really excellent Southern officers. They all rose. And that kind of dedication, you know, to try to cross the desert in June and July. And the same on the Union side. We really had, you know, very high quality officers, at least until enough were trained here so that they could begin to fill the higher offices.
I have the sense that it comes partly from the portrait photographs of the Indian chiefs that are so grand and fine and expressive, but I have the sense that the troops, the federal troops, admired the Indians. Is that
it went both ways? I've done a fair amount of reading among the diaries of these people, and there were quite a number of them that admired their fighting skills. If you were on campaign, if you were the California column and you were policing New Mexico, you were scared of the Apaches because they could pop out of nowhere. They really knew the desert and they knew how to, you know, fight in that terrain. But there was also a fair amount of racial contempt. And one of the campaigns that I didn't cover here because of time featured a massacre up in Idaho, the Bear River fight. And it's a horrible story to read. I mean, California troops really disgraced themselves. And it was because they wanted to fight Confederates. This regiment even volunteered their own salaries to pay for the transportation back east. But the Army said, no, we need you out in the West. And so their commander, who was a terrific soldier, but, you know, not necessarily a nice guy, decided that he was going to take it out on the local Shoshone people, the Northwestern Shoshone.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And it was a vicious massacre. It's just sickening to read about. So the answer to your question is there was a lot of both. And I think more than anything, there was a lot of, I don't want to be out here fighting Indians. it's right. Dangerous. It's scary. And it's miserable work. Whether they liked the Indians or not, there were many disappointed California volunteers. Let's put it that way.
Okay.
Yeah.
Understood. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. Well, thank you, folks. And I'll make sure that Ann has some contact information for you. I should have had it out here. Oh, and by the way, I'm working on this multimedia aspect. I like this Zoom business because I used to have to drive everywhere to give these presentations. And that's nice because I can see the audience. But Zoom actually offers me the chance to give presentations at a great range. So if you know anybody who's interested, that California Educational Multimedia site offers a range of speeches, you know, presentations that I've got. And I will be troubleshooting this technology until I trust it. And then I'll be available to give the talks that are listed there. So anyway, thank you for persevering. I had no idea whether you were out there. I was in a complete bubble as soon as I started talking. And I didn't
know. We're all here.
Okay. And I could have been talking to space. You could have all been sitting there saying, oh, darn, you know, I wish this had worked. Anybody want to? Yeah. Okay. Rosemary.
Yeah. You're going to have a video of this, right? Because I had to miss some of it.
Yes, I recorded it, and I guess I'm still recording it. Anyway, I'll clip the beginning and end off, and I'll make it available to, I'll send it to Ann, and I don't know what she does with them, but my understanding is that they will be available. Or Jim, would you be the right technical contact?
I think Ann is the right one. I think.
Okay, yeah, MP4, and I'll just look at that as soon as I can, and you know, make sure that it's technically sound, and if it is, I'll send it right along. If it isn't, I'll record it again because I want to have it in the can. Just, you know, don't worry. It'll be there one way or another. Okay. Well, that's about it from this side. I want to thank y'all. And
thank you.
I'll see you another time.
Yeah.
Okay. Bye-bye. Yeah. I'm going to end the meeting if I can.
Fascinating.
Yeah, here we go.
And great images.
Oh, yeah. I was so pleased and to find out what there was out there. It was just amazing. It was a treat. Anyway, thank you again. Bye-bye.
Really added. Thank-